Your Honor, I would like to recall my witness for a couple of rebuttal questions.
Okay.
Your Honor, Ms. Vick, it has been testified by your husband that there have been times where you have been somewhat neglectful to your children. There has been some testimony offered with respect to him stating that he doesn't speed or generally doesn't drive recklessly. What can you tell me, if anything, about this? First of all, about neglect. Do you neglect your children, Ms. Vick, or have you in the past neglected your children in any capacity?
Absolutely not. I've always been there for my children in every way that I can possibly be. I'm a single mom now and doing everything for them, and they are not neglected. They are fed and well off.
Okay. Tell me about anything else you can tell me about, you know, coming home from work. Did Mr. Fick ever neglect the children in any capacity?
Yes, I believe, to my knowledge, in my opinion, yes, because I would come home from work. They would be hungry. Their face would be dirty. They would be waiting for me to cook dinner. I would always cook dinner after work, after a 10-hour shift. Chris would never do it. I was pretty much, you know, doing everything. It seems like all he did was lay on the couch, watch TV, and neglect the children.
Tell me about, the only reason I brought this up was because Mr. Fick indicated that he doesn't speak. And that's a pretty definitive term to me. So when I heard that, in light of some things you told me, I questioned that. I questioned the incident, and I asked him about whether or not he drove recklessly with you and David in the car. And there was an instance where that was an issue, correct?
Yes.
And what can you tell me about that?
We were on our way to church when I was trying to download a form on my phone. So I had my head down. It was a form for our insurance. And I felt a huge, like we had hit something. It scared me. I looked up and Chris had hit the curb. So I began to ask him why he hit the curb. Then he got hostile with me and slammed the brakes. Unfortunately, Adam had unbuckled David's seat because he likes to play with the seat belts in the back. And David went flying and ended up causing a bloody mouth, bloody face. I got a little upset with Chris, and we started throwing punches at each other. I don't really think anyone got punched. It was more just an anger expression toward each other. So I got out of the car and buckled David back in and wiped up his face. And then we ended up going back home.
You didn't go to church that day?
I don't remember. I think I suggested that we go back home. Yes, we did end up going to church. It was a vacation Bible school, and the kids went to VBS.
Okay. Which is a Baptist program, correct?
Yes.
I don't have any further questions. Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Bailey, any questions?
Just a couple. I just want to follow up on a question about that incident where David went flying, apparently in the car. You're saying he was unbuckled in the car seat?
Are you talking to me?
I am.
Okay. To my knowledge, the car seat was buckled when we got in the car to leave. But Adam plays with the seat belts. It's just an autistic thing. He loves to push buttons. And my guess is he pushed the buttons. And when that incident happened, the car seat was not secured anymore.
All right. So my question is pretty straightforward. He was not buckled at the time that he was partially injured on this incident you're describing.
Correct.
And Chris was driving and you were sort of responsible for the children.
I don't know how I'm responsible.
Would Chris be in a better position to know if David was buckled, or would you?
Either one of us. I mean, we both loaded up the children. It was probably both our responsibilities to check.
Well, you said he became unbuckled at some point. You're not aware of when?
I'm not aware of when. I mean, it has happened to me before in the past where Adam had did unbuckle. And fortunately, I caught it, but that time I did not. I don't know when it was done.
All right. But you'd agree with me that you'd be in the best position to know what was going on with your children in the back seat while Chris drove, correct?
During driving, yes, but I don't always look back.
Okay. All right. That's all I have, Judge.
Okay. Anything else, Mr. Padilla?
No, Your Honor.
Okay, thank you. Any additional rebuttal, Mr. Padel?
Nothing further, Your Honor.
Anything else, Mr. Bailey?
I have no rebuttal witnesses, Your Honor.
Okay. What are your thoughts as we proceed? I could take closing arguments at this time, but it looks like based upon that I may have to speak to David, so I'll have to have him come in. Who is David with today, with a plaintiff or defendant?
He's with me, Your Honor.
Okay. And would you have the ability to get David in or have somebody bring him in at, let's say, at 1 o'clock or 1:15?
I can have him on the phone, but my internet connection is not working. But I can get him on the phone for you.
No, I mean in person.
In person?
Yes. To be brought to the courthouse.
Yes.
If you brought him in, how long would it take you to get him back home? I'm just trying to think, okay, if you brought him at 1, would you be able to get him back home? Well, you could get on the phone then at that point. So you'd be able to get on by 1:30, correct?
Yes.
Judge, may I be heard on this issue? What would your thoughts be if the parties, I mean, the child just turned 5, what would your thought be if the parties waived the personal appearance?
I wasn't planning on bringing him in. And as I was prepping the other night, then I realized he just had a birthday, so he turned 5. It's always been my procedure and routine. If they're 5 or older, then I'll interview them. If they're under 5, I won't. But sounds like, Mr. Bailey, you're saying you don't believe there's any necessity or that you're going to waive interviewing him. Is that correct?
Well, obviously, that's a mutual decision. They both have the right to have the child interviewed. I believe that my client would be okay for that to not happen and just proceed to closing arguments and decision as opposed to running the child.
Mr. Padel, what's your thoughts?
I'm not in complete disagreement. I'm kind of, you know, this isn't the child's only 5. I don't think the child can really opine as to a public or a private school. They don't know any different. They can't pick between the two because they don't know any different, really, other than maybe they can talk about the fact that maybe he does or doesn't like, you know, his current, you know, school situation or if he enjoyed that. But I don't, as it relates to parenting time schedule, I mean, maybe he could indicate whether or not he thinks.
Well, I wouldn't get into anything with him on the parenting time schedule. Obviously, as Mr. Bailey pointed out in his trial brief, the court does have to consider the best interest of the child factors as it relates to school. And so I would pertain to that. I would not address any issues concerning parenting time with him.
Okay. Ms. Fick, do you feel like there would be any value in having the judge speak with David about his experience at school so far or anything like that? Or would you agree with your husband that there's not a lot of value in bringing him?
I would tend to agree.
Which way? Agree with what?
I would tend to agree that you're probably not going to get enough, you know, many answers out of him.
Okay. So are you willing to waive that? The judge is willing to talk to this child and he will if you want him to. Are you saying that you're okay with the judge not taking that into consideration?
Yeah, I'm okay if he doesn't, but if the judge wants to speak to my child, that's fine with me.
Okay. Your Honor, I'll lean on the sound discretion of the court then.
Okay. Well, if you wish the court to do it, what I don't want to get into a situation where I don't interview the child and then the parties would utilize that as a basis for appeal and that the court had not considered all of the best interest factors. So that's what I'm looking at. If you want me to do it, I'm happy to do it. We'll do it. But if the parties believe that there's no utility to it and the court's not going to get anything out of it, then they have a right to waive that. That's my thought. And I would tell you, I've had a number of instances recently where I've interviewed 5-year-olds, and quite frankly, rarely does it prove to be very beneficial.
Well, in recognizing that the law does not support any specific age for which a child can be interviewed and or the consideration taken into or their position taken into consideration, with both parties stipulating that the child is probably not old enough to express a preference that the court can consider, I'm willing to waive.
Okay. And Mr. Bale, you're willing to waive as well?
Yeah, Judge, we're willing to waive. And the current case law does say that you have the best interest factors to make a determination, but it also states that it's odd to use custody factors and parenting time factors in school, but it, so that the court can find that some of those factors have no relevance. I believe that his preference would have no relevance at all.
Yeah. Okay. And that's very typical. And quite frankly, in dealing with school issues in the past, many of those factors are not end up being very relevant, nor again, very illustrative as it relates to the school issue either. So, okay, the court will, based upon the agreement of the parties, the court will in fact waive that and eliminate the need to interview the child. At this point, why don't we come back at 1 o'clock? We'll have closing arguments, and then the court would be able to provide a ruling at that time after the closing arguments.
For defendant.
Good afternoon, and welcome back.
Afternoon.
Good afternoon, Your Honor.
When we broke, we were at the point of presenting the closing arguments. So, Mr. Padal, you can proceed with your closing.
Thank you, Your Honor, and I will be brief. I don't want to take too much of the court's time on this. As I indicated in my opening statement, Your Honor, I truly believe that this case was a case more about what was convenient for the defendant in this case, rather than a meaningful want for the child to attend a specific school. That was highlighted by testimony that the defendant had not actually conveyed that to the plaintiff, that he wanted the child to go to this Adventist Christian school in Charlotte. And while it's certainly true that both parties testified adversely to that fact, the court will have to make a decision as to who it found more credible in that scenario. That being said, Your Honor, I believe the testimony showed today that the defendant was not overly familiar with the Christian school that he had chose. In fact, that it was an Adventist Christian school. And by my account, they have their own set of prophets that they believe in, and that no other Christian religion believes in. Yet both of these individuals hold themselves out to be Christians. So I see a conflict with that. My client provided testimony that she was not comfortable with an Adventist Christian school. And when the defendant was asked about whether or not he would be okay with a public school in Charlotte, he said, yes. Yeah, I'm totally fine with that. Well, and to me, that says he's not very interested in the private school as much as he's interested in not having to commute. That was a big portion of the defendant's testimony, that he was not interested in doing that, that would take time away from the time that he could spend with the child in terms of having to drive. But the reality is there's going to be a drive for one of these parents no matter what. And that's what I've been highlighting since the beginning of this case. I would point out that, you know, the drive times involved here are not, you know, egregious times. You know, we're talking 35, 40 minute drive to school versus, you know, and it's going to shift to one parent over the other. And the testimony reflects that the dad is much more capable in terms of his flexibility to provide some transportation for the child than that of the mom. Mom testified that she would have to essentially quit her job and try to find a new job if the court were to order the child attend school in Battle Creek or in Charlotte. Additionally, there was testimony that the children would be attending the same school together, their siblings. To me, it makes sense that we would try to keep these children in the same school environment.
Oh, hold on 1 second, please, Mr. Padal. No. Ms. Fick?
Yes, Your Honor.
Do you have the children or child with you?
Yes, I do.
You need to make sure and change so that's not a situation. I don't want the child involved in these proceedings where the child could even hear what's going on. So I don't know where you're at or what the problem is, but you're going to have to make sure that the child is not present.
Oh, I'm sorry. They're in the other room with a babysitter. I will make sure that they don't come in.
Okay. Well, I could hear them pretty clearly. So I thought they were in the room with you or in the vehicle with you or wherever you were.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that.
Okay. Sorry, Mr. Padal, but go ahead.
Thank you, Your Honor. The testimony from the defendant, he never indicated that he was unable to transport the children to school. In fact, it was quite to the contrary. He indicated in his testimony that he had flexibility in his schedule and that he could offer these types of benefits to the child. And that's exactly what I see them as, Your Honor, benefits to the child. You know, what is, at the end of the day, we're looking at the best interests of the child for the best interest factors. And by my account, the best interest of this child is going to be served when both parents can actively be involved and can maintain stable employment to provide care for the child and otherwise. And all the testimony that we heard today was that, you know, depending on where the school goes, it certainly has the potential to upset at least one family, new family in this scenario, and that's mom's. Mom would potentially have to quit her job and find something else, whereas dad wouldn't have to do any of those things. With that, Your Honor, I think the court will make the right decision here. Like I said, I will be brief on this. I don't think that this is an overly pressing issue. What I do believe to be true is that a Christian school and the Adventist faith is not appropriate in this case. And so if it comes down to public school to public school, there was no testimony offered really by either party, to be fair, in any substance as terms of whether the schools in Penfield are any better or worse than schools, public schools in Charlotte. What I will say is that the defendant offered some rather derogatory sentiment towards, you know, the children and or people that bring their kids to school in Penfield, and that he was disinterested in allowing his own child to attend those schools. But the reality of the situation is we live in a very diverse world and community these days, and that's going to be the same no matter where this child goes to school. So I'm confident that the court will reach the right decision in this matter and grant the relief that my client is asking. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Bailey.
All right, Judge. Well, let's talk about one issue here briefly, and that's the parenting time schedule. The parenting time schedule that's in place is pursuant to the temporary order that was entered in January. The parties have been exercising parenting time in accordance with that schedule. They both agreed that joint physical custody is in the child's best interest. Therefore, to change the parenting time schedule would require, in my view, a preponderance of evidence, as it would not change the existing custodial environment. There really was no evidence to support changing the current schedule, other than Ms. Fick said that she would prefer to have more time with them as opposed to a longer block of time, more frequent visits. My client testified that the visits were that the parenting time schedule was going well. The child was adjusted to it. He stated some legitimate concerns about all of the transportation that would be required in the event of so much back and forth with the exchanges. It still is a very young child. Some of the challenges there. So I don't believe there's been any real evidence to support that the parenting time schedule should be modified at all. So going forward here with making the presumption that the parenting time schedule will remain as is, then the issue boils down to school. And I've heard counsel say that this is about convenience for the defendant, but it really seems like this is the pot calling the kettle black in terms of who is it convenient for. A couple of things jump out at me here. There will be transportation required. And under the case law right now, we have to look at the best interest factors. I think there's two really that apply in this case that are at least germane to the issue at hand. One is H, which is the home, school, and community record of the child. And then the other is L, anything else that the court wants to take into account. So let's talk first about the school. My client talked about, provided evidence of smaller classrooms, higher academic performance. He talked about the meeting with the school officials, getting a family oriented feeling towards it, and just believing overall it would be in a good environment. Now, when pressed, he was asked about whether or not children develop sometimes differently. And the answer, of course, is yes. But in this particular instance, my clients expressed some specific concerns about the learning, where the child was on the learning curve right now. He's about to start kindergarten. He has taken the time to hire to utilize a tutor. He's taken the time to work with the child during times when the tutor's not there regarding arithmetic and alphabet and some of the things that we would expect a kindergartner to be able to handle. He's worked with him, and he's got the time to work with him. He also testified that when the child comes back to him, he doesn't seem to have progressed from where they left off, which suggests to me that he's the one that's more involved in the academic performance of the child, and therefore I believe is favored in that factor. Now, under L, here's the situation. Counsel attempted to basically say there's very little difference in the drive. And my client pointed out, as this would apply to Ms. Fick too, you have to drive the child all the way to school, then you drive back with an empty car, then you drive the child to pick the child up in an empty car, and then drive with the child back. That's a lot of driving with the child. It's a lot of driving in general. That's four trips, there, back. That's a lot of driving. And somebody's going to have to do it. It's not convenient for Ms. Fick because she said that she would likely have to get a new job. Getting a new job didn't particularly bother her when she left from the marital home and to move to Battle Creek. You could argue that she maybe was a situation where she needed to get out of the house, and that would be fine. But did she have to move 35, 40 minutes away? She chose to do that. Now, a couple things are obvious that didn't necessarily come up that I will bring up in the closing argument. Mr. Fick testified that he has owned his home for over 20 years. He farms there. He owns the home. It's farmland. He testified that his son enjoys being on that spot. Ms. Fick testified that she rents. So there's an obvious solution here, and that is that if it's not very far to drive, Ms. Fick would be in a position to move closer to the marital home or to the school district where the child would go, which it sounds like they neither of them are opposed to Charlotte. Both of them agree that Eaton Rapids is probably not in their child's best interest, whether that's in public school or in private schools. But she could easily move and make that extra drive, which council has said is not very far, so that she would drive to work and she could drive back. That's two. That's there and that's back. I think it's important to point out that Ms. Fick is the one that made the decision to move to Grand Rapids. Okay, you can do that. Sure, you can move where you want to move. But when you share equal custody and you have a child that is starting school, then you have a situation where somebody is going to have to drive more. Now she said, well, my babysitter's not willing to do that. Yes, probably not. Not where she currently resides. And maybe she'd have to find a new babysitter, but she's going to have a babysitter doing a lot of the driving anyway. And there, with her starting work at 5 o'clock in the morning, this would require by Mr. Podel's own calculations with his Google Maps, it would require her to drive another 20, 25 minutes each way. To me, that's a small price to pay to have the child be in the community where the child was raised. Now, again, they apparently didn't agree, or they both agreed that Eaton Rapids is not appropriate. Fine. But the plaintiff said that Charlotte offers some opportunities that she wouldn't be opposed to if they lived in the same community. There's absolutely no reason. That's a choice that the plaintiff made, continues to make, to live 35, 40 minutes away from what was the marital home. This isn't to punish her, but there's a practical solution. That practical solution is with her, not with my client driving 40 minutes back, 40 minutes there to pick up the child, 40 minutes back. That's 2 hours plus just for the child, and closer to 3.5 hours for him to be in the car each time he takes the child, when there's such a more practical solution to this particular concern. So my request, Judge, is this. We keep the parenting time schedule the same. It ain't broke. We shouldn't be trying to fix it. The child's adjusted. They both agree joint physical custody is in the best interest. They currently live quite a distance apart from each other. Two, we're talking about the end of June right now. So we're looking at September before the child starts school for kindergarten. I believe that under factors H and L, they favor my client in this matter. I believe that the school district should be in the Charlotte school district. My client offered solid testimony that this isn't necessarily a religious-based institution, but they focus on the academics that are necessary for a child to achieve with two teachers for 8 to 9 students. I think sounds like a great environment. My client's testimony about Battle Creek wasn't, you know, yes, there's diversity, but this isn't to suggest there isn't diversity there. He testified that he had concerns about being in a high crime district, and which is where the plaintiff currently lives. So that's what I believe what the evidence has pointed us today, Your Honor, and I appreciate your time and willingness to make this decision for us.
Thank you. Mr. Podel, anything else?
Your Honor, just a couple of things. I do want to highlight here that I don't know that the court should favor one party over the other in terms of, you know, a community of record, so to speak. One, this child is too young to even have one established. Two, Dad's not proposing a school in Eaton Rapids, and neither is Mom, for that matter. You know, Charlotte and Eaton Rapids are two totally different places. And so irrespective of whether the child, if the child goes to school in Battle Creek, at least the child is in a community of record where Mom is establishing a basis in a home. If the child goes to school in Charlotte, that becomes a nil set because neither party is living there. So I just want to point that out. The other only and final comment that I will make on this is I think that counsel for the defendant is kind of over-exaggerating a little bit when he says that, you know, it's just as simple as mom can move. Mom's a single mom with a full-time job and two kids. One of them is autistic. It's just not that easy to move, Your Honor. And I think everyone knows that. We're at a place right now where, again, I will reiterate, I think this is a convenience thing. Neither party is opposed to Charlotte. Mom's only, you know, red flag here. She's like, hey, this is going to create a huge upset in my life. I'm going to have to make some major changes to even accommodate this. And dad has nothing but to do it by getting a car and drive a little bit. And maybe this is my own prejudice here, but at the end of the day, closing argument is not evidence, so I can say it. And it's this. I drove my son to school 52 minutes a day each way for a period of 5 years. The idea that it's lost time with your child is unpersuasive to me, because you can use that time to speak with your child. And guess what? They can't run off and play because they're buckled in a car seat. They got to listen to you or fall asleep. And I did that for a long time with my son. It helped me build a relationship with him. So I'm not compelled by that. And I hope that the court finds its way to make the right decision in favor of the plaintiff in this case. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, in this particular case, the court will note that, again, I've heard the evidence today. I've also reviewed all the pleadings in this particular case. The court has, thankfully, Mr. Bailey, I appreciate your trial brief. The court does note that the court has reviewed the Lombardo and the Piran case. The Piran case, I've looked at the Court of Appeals finding as well as the Supreme Court finding. Obviously, it's one of those instances I'll have to say that the Court of Appeals seem to be much more thorough in depth than the Supreme Court. They seem to gloss over and not go into the depth. Again, of course, some of that's because they affirm the Court of Appeals, but the court does find that the Court of Appeals opinion was very, very thorough and helpful in these types of cases. As stated in those particular cases, and as the attorneys know, that cases of this type, the court has, as Piran had stated, the court has to consider whether an established custodial environment exists, because, again, that established custodial environment may have an impact as it relates to the issue of schooling. An established custodial environment exists if over an appreciable time the child naturally looks to the custodian in that environment for guidance, discipline, the necessities of life, and parental comfort. The statute provides that the age of the child, the physical environment, and the inclination of the custodian and the child as to the permanency of the relationship shall be considered. The court will note that an established custodial environment may exist in more than one home. In this particular matter, I'll tell you, there was very scant evidence concerning the established custodial environment, and that's why the court did review the pleadings, and the court can glean from those pleadings where that particular established custodial environment is, as the court did back in January when the court set a temporary custody order in place. The court will find that, again, looking at what I can glean from the pleadings and what I could get from the minimal testimony presented today, that, again, there is an established custodial environment with both of the parties. The court believe that at the time of the temporary order, and even more so at this particular time, in that, again, both of the parties have established that they have that sort of a custodial environment where the child looks to them for guidance, discipline, necessity, life, and parental comfort. Why is that important? It's important because with the established custodial environment, with both of the parties, as we see in Piran, that, again, the determination as to what the court does as it relates to the school would be, the court would state, the court did state in that, that if there is no change in an established custodial environment, the heightened evidentiary burden is not applicable. In that case, the defendant, who I believe was the mother in that case, she only required a proof by a preponderance of evidence that a change in school would be in the best interest of the minor children. So the court is looking at it from that standpoint as to, again, the burden is by a preponderance of evidence. The court would note that, again, a little bit of change in the, the testimony over the pleadings in this case previously is that the trial brief did address the issue of the Adventist Christian school. And there was the exhibit, defendant's exhibit B, which was attached, that extols the virtues of that school. The court will note, however, in this case, that both of the parties stated there, neither is a member of the Adventist church, that they know very little about the Adventist church, and simply the defendant had testified, however, that again, that they are Christians and he liked that aspect of it. And again, that's admirable. And I do find in cases of this nature that Christian schools are a good alternative for children when they're, again, when they're in formative ages, et cetera. In this particular matter as well, the defendant had testified about the class size, that there were two teachers. They had, I think, 8 to 9 students. There was no other testimony from the plaintiff as to class size or anything of that nature, only as to, as she said, there were good reviews given on the Purdy School. And so the court is going to take all of that into consideration this matter. But as I go through the best interest factors, the court has to look at the first factor, the love, affection, and other emotional ties existing between the parties involved and the child. In this case, I'll tell you, at least as it relates to testimony today, the testimony and the evidence was almost devoid as it relates to the best interest factors, except as Mr. Bailey has stated, to factor H and factor L in this particular matter. So it does appear, based upon the pleadings previously and what had happened on a temporary basis, that, again, it did appear that there was, both of the parties had exhibited love, affection, other emotional ties with the child. I don't find any of this, I don't find any evidence showing this favors either of the parties. I'll find that this factor is equal. Next factor is the capacity and disposition of the parties involved to give the child love, affection, guidance, and continuation of the education of raising the child in a particular religion or creed. Obviously, there's been no testimony about religion other than that the parties did occasionally go to church, the Baptist church, which really is not applicable in this matter. They went together, they went with the child, and it's not like they were attempting to raise the child in a Baptist Christian school, if you would. Court does not find any favor to either party of this factor. Next factor is capacity and disposition of the parties involved to provide the child with food, clothing, medical care, and other remedial care recognized or permitted in place of medical care. There's been really no testimony about that factor in the testimony today, although it does appear there's been no complaints by either of the party as to, again, providing the child with the material needs when they're with the other parent. So the court will not weigh this factor in favor of either party. Next factor is the length of time the child has lived in a stable, satisfactory environment, the desirability of maintaining continuity. The child had been for a substantial period of time when the child grew up in the home that the defendant is now in. The plaintiff has moved to the home that she's now in. She moved back in November of 2022. Each of the parties have testified that they have no plans to move and will continue in the current homes. As a result, the court will find that this factor is equal as to both parties. Next factor is the permanency of the family unity, existing or proposed custodial homes. There's been no testimony about this factor, and as a result, the court will not consider it. Likewise, the next factor is the moral fitness of the parties. There have been no testimony about moral fitness, and as a result, the court will not consider that factor as well. Next factor is the mental and physical health of the parties. The parties have not testified to this, and as a result, the court will not consider that factor in favor of either of the parties. Next factor is the homeschooling community record of the child in this matter. Again, there was some testimony in this case about that, about, again, being in the home of both of the parties. The court would note that that there was neither party testified about any community record. And obviously at the child just turning age 5, would, again, for the most part, without some testimony, the court can't infer any community record. So the court's not going to do so. I have to look simply at the home and school record. And in this matter, the court would note that if I look at any school record, the child did attend at the Purdy School, the pre-kindergarten. There'd been very little of any testimony from the plaintiff about that. So the court can't infer what that was. I have heard testimony from the defendant about him providing tutoring and providing assistance to the child. Unfortunately, when the parties were together, they've each, attempt to at least in some way disparage the other party today about claiming the other party being negligent and the child not being up to his peers in this matter, and that either each party should have done more when the parties were together. But the court will note they didn't in this matter, that again, the tutoring is only something recent that the defendant has done after realizing and finding that the child was not maybe as advanced with his peers, but as brought out as well, it does appear that, you know, children do learn at a different level. And as a result, the court cannot, at this point at least, when the child is just going into kindergarten, cannot find that, again, any deficiencies the child has is the result of being in either of the parties' home. The court will find this factor to be equal as to both parties. Next factor is the reasonable preference of the child. And again, pursuant to the Piron case, the court would have to take into account the reasonable preference of the child, but the parties had stipulated that the child would not have a reasonable preference in this particular matter. And as a result, they waived consideration of that particular factor. Next factor is the willingness and ability of each of the parties to facilitate a close and continued parent-child relationship with the other party. It does not appear that there's been no testimony about that, so the court's not going to weigh and take into consideration that factor, as it does not appear to be applicable in this case. Next factor is the domestic violence, regardless of whether violence was directed against or witnessed by the child. There was only brief testimony about one instance in the car when the defendant hit the curb, and the parties, again, were, as the plaintiff stated, were exchanging and attempting to hit each other, but neither of them ever landed any blows in this particular matter. And the court could look at that as kind of being a mutual combat situation at the very best in this case. But it doesn't appear that that is really an issue that the court would consider, as again, it was mutual conduct by both of the parties. And again, it had not happened at any time after that, simply on this one occasion in the car. So the court's not going to weigh that factor in favor of either party. Next factor is any other factor considered by the court to be relevant in the particular dispute. And the court does consider there'd be some relevance as I weigh the equities in the particular case. In this matter, a lot is dependent upon this case, upon the transportation issue. As it relates to transportation, court notes in the pretty school, child would be attending 8:30 to 3:45, that in this case, the plaintiff works from 5:15 a.m. to 3:45 p.m. She has a babysitter that, again, individual by the name of Shannon, who comes over in the morning, gets the children up from school or up from bed, gets them ready for school, feeds them breakfast, gets them off to school or off to the bus that meets the children at the end of the driveway. The court would note as well that, again, if David is going to stay in Purdy, he would be going to the same school that he went to last year when he was in pre-kindergarten. The parties had talked about private schools. They talked about neither of them appeared to object to any public school in Charlotte area, and they were not opposed to that. But the issue with the plaintiff was the transportation in this matter. Court will note that, as she stated, if she is going to have to transport the child to school, wherever it would be other than at her current address where the child could be picked up from the bus, she'd have to get other babysitters. She would have to get another job because she would not be able to work and provide transportation to the child in the weeks that are not her particular weeks with the child. And again, that would cause substantial financial burden as well as other upheaval in the home if she's having to move, get a new job and all of that. The court does note that, again, the distance between the defendant's home and the Purdy school is approximately, I think it was, yeah, some places different. I have the distance between was 29.8 miles. Only later that was brought up that it was more like 38 miles between the homes. And again, if they were going to go to Charlotte, it was an additional 11 miles. So it means that the defendant would have to provide transportation additional 27 miles one way to school, as opposed to, again, the 11 miles if it was in the Charlotte district. The court notes, when I look at the equities in this matter, that again, the only upheaval, if you would, or burdensome impact to the defendant is, again, that traveling the additional 27 miles with the child two times per day for the days that he has the child, And I would agree that as they state that the attorneys are not good with math, because Mr. Padel kept looking at this and say, well, it's less than an hour. Well, it's less than an hour that the child has to travel, but it's two additional hours that the defendant has to travel. But the court does note, if the plaintiff were to lose her job, leave the job and have to transport to Charlotte, but likewise, she would have to, in fact, transport the same amount of time in this case. So the issue is whether the additional 27 miles on those days would outweigh the impact to the plaintiff in this particular case of having to lose the employment, lose her babysitter, have to move, all for, again, transportation of an additional two times per day for those 5 days per week. The court, in weighing those particular equities, believes that the equities do weigh in favor of the plaintiff in this particular matter. And as a result, the court will find that, in fact, the plaintiff has met her burden by a preponderance of evidence to keep the child enrolled in the Purdy school district. Court will next address the issue concerning the parenting time, as that has been raised. Parenting time is, again, statutorily provided by MCL 722.27A. And again, parenting time is granted in accordance with the best interest of the child. And the court has to weigh those factors, which I have done already in this matter. But the court also has to consider the following factors: any special circumstances or needs of the child. The court will note that both of the parties have testified that the child does not have any special circumstances or special needs. So the court will not consider that. The child is not less than 1 year of age, not nursing. So the court will not consider that factor. Next factor is likelihood of abuse or neglect of a child during parenting time. There's been no testimony whatsoever about that, so the court will not consider it. Next, the likelihood of abuse of a parent during the exercise of parenting time. Likewise, there's been no testimony about that, so the court will not consider that factor. Next factor is the inconvenience or burdensome impact of travel on the child. The court has already considered that in weighing the equities in this particular matter, but I am weighing it in consideration of the parenting time issue as well. Obviously, if the court would do as the plaintiff has requested, the child would be required to be on the road more often than the child already is, and more often than the child will be in far as for transportation to school. So the court is taking into account that there is going to be significantly more transportation of the child if, in fact, the court were to go to a 223 or 225, whatever the case may be. Next factor is whether parents reasonably expected to exercise their ordered parenting time. The court does find that the parties have always exercise their parenting time. That's not an issue. And there's been no threatened or actual detention of the child, so the court is not taking that into consideration. Any other relevant factors? I am taking the relevant factors as the court has cited as it relates to the best interest of the child test in this matter. And when I do that and look at the additional transportation that would be necessitated if I were to change the parenting time, there's also been no testimony that the parenting time has not been working well in this particular matter. Neither the plaintiff nor the defendant had testified to that. That the defendant had testified that it was working well, that he thought it was good, that again, that plaintiff has not really addressed that particular factor as to whether, again, it was not working. And so the court can only infer that it was or is in this particular matter. When I take all of the best interest of the child factors into consideration, as well as the additional nine as it relates to parenting time, the court is firmly convinced that there is no basis to change the parenting time schedule from an alternating weekly basis in this particular case. So the court will leave that particular parenting time schedule in place, as I do believe it is in the best interest of the child. With that, I think that addresses all of the issues the court is required to address today. Is there anything, Mr. Padel, that the court has failed to address or not address that you believe is that I need to before we conclude?
No, Your Honor, I'm just seeking a little bit of clarification about, well, we're the plaintiff in this case, so I'll be drafting the judgment. In addition, we need a USO consistent with the party's financial status. And so I don't know that, other than simple proofs that were taken today with respect to the party's incomes, I don't think the court has found a basis for that. Maybe they did at the temporary hearing. I'd be happy to provide a USO to Brother Counsel so we can get that wrapped up with the judgment. Just
you can provide that to Mr. Bailey, and then again, if there's an issue, you'll have to bring it back before the court, because again, that issue was not before the court today. I know there was testimony taken of it, but both of the parties acknowledged when we went in that the two issues were the parenting time and the school issue, and as a result, that issue was not before the court today. See if you can't come to a resolution, and if so, that's great, and if not, then you can bring the matter back before the court.
Very well, Your Honor.
Mr. Bailey, is there anything you believe the court has omitted or failed to address before we conclude?
No, I agree with Mr. Podol that there has to be a uniform child support order included, and so I am not opposed to trying to work that out with between us. I understand the court's ruling. That would be incorporated with what we've already done at mediation. My only question would be, since we're here, I don't recall statutory proofs being entered. Maybe that's something we could get done today so that the parties wouldn't need to come back and appear and do that.
We can do that. Ms. Fick, in this matter, back on or about November 14, 2022, you filed a complaint for divorce in this matter. And at the time you filed that, were all of the statements contained in the complaint true?
Yes.
Do they remain true?
Yes.
You stated that you had resided in the state of Michigan and the county of Calhoun for more than 180 days immediately preceding the filing of the complaint. Is that correct?
In the state of Michigan for 180 days before filing the
complaint for divorce.
Yes.
Is that correct? Okay. And in this matter, you also state that there has been a breakdown of the marital relationship to the extent the object of matrimony has been destroyed, and there remains no reasonable likelihood that the marriage can be preserved. Is that correct?
Yes.
Is there any chance that you and the defendant could reconcile and live together as husband and wife?
I don't think so.
Are you currently pregnant, ma'am?
No.
Okay, thank you. The court will find that the testimony does establish the statutory basis. There has been a showing there's been a breakdown of the marital relationship. The court will preserve the proofs in this matter pending receipt of the judgment that the Mr. Podol will be preparing consistent with the ruling today on those other matters, as well as to the findings that they had at and agreements they had at mediation. With that, and Mr. Bailey, anything else?
Nothing from my client, Your Honor. I'm clear on your decision. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Podol, anything else?
Your Honor, I just want to say, I didn't realize you were asking for the pro-com proofs. I know those by heart. I thought you were referring to the child support question, so I was trying to pull those up. My apologies.
No, that's fine. Okay, that will conclude this particular matter. We will end at 1:48 p.m. You're free to go. Have a good day, and we'll look forward to getting that.